In a 1986 United States Department of State paper entitled, it's actually January 1987 paper entitled The U.S. Policy Towards South Africa, a section entitled Political Leadership in a Post-South Africa says, and I quote, "The shape of South Africa's future will depend above all else on the qualities and character of the individuals who assume positions of leadership in a post-apartheid South Africa. On this point, the advisory committee finds considerable grounds for optimism. One of the most important is the pluralistic character of black politics in South Africa. That stands as a test yet to be realized, wouldn't we say? His Excellency Tebogo Mafole, the permanent representative of the African National Congress to the United Nations, is by training a lawyer from a South African university. He was active in the student movement which gave rise to the 1976 democratic uprisings in Soweto. Mr. Mafole joined the African National Congress and served in its international relations division. From 1982 to 1986, he was a permanent representative of the liberation movement, the ANC, to Cairo. He comes to New York, to the United Nations, directly from Lusaka, where he served as head of the section of the international division of ANC, heading up the international organizations, including the responsibilities for the United Nations. At a moment when the activity and support for liberation, real democratic liberation, inside South Africa and in Namibia, is once again forefront on the agenda of the United Nations and in the US, the ANC has sent here to us in the U.S. Tebogo Mafole, who has only been in New York for 2 weeks and who has only been in Boston for 2 hours.
Thank you very much. We have listened with very rapt attention to the presentations that were made by Dr. Ungo and Dr. Jagan, who very, very adequately covered the theme insofar as it relates to the third world, or, with due apologies, the developing world. What I intend to do, is this okay? What we propose to do today is to try and handle this topic. We will attempt at discussing this topic, paying particular attention to the situation in Southern Africa. It is a truism of contemporary international relations that the prevailing international political climate is to a great measure shaped and determined by the character of relations between the two major world powers, the USA and the USSR. It is also indisputable that such relations tend to impact on and greatly influence the destinies of the various regions of the world, especially the developing world, to the extent that each region is perceived as a highly contested arena in the struggle for the safeguarding or expanding of their spheres of influence. Thus, the third world countries, engaged as they are in the struggle against colonialism, neocolonialism, and all other forms of oppression, are directly or indirectly affected in their efforts by the fluctuations in the relations that exist between the East and the West, especially as manifested in the relations between the USA and the USSR. It therefore comes as no surprise that at the height of the Cold War, whose reflection in the USA was a sinister communist witch hunt carried out by the House Un-American Activities Committee, headed by Senator Joe McCarthy, a corresponding phenomenon surfaced in South Africa following the coming to power of the Nationalist Party in 1948. In the face of the massive popular upsurge, the high point of which was the greatest ever strike in the history of black workers in South Africa, that is the mine worker strike of 1946, the racist government, fired by its rabid anti-communist propaganda, passed what was called the Suppression of Communism Act. The ANC and the oppressed people were not deceived into thinking that the act was intended solely for the communists. Indeed, Walter Sisulu, who was then Secretary General of the ANC and who is presently serving life imprisonment with his colleague Nelson Mandela, displayed a highly remarkable grasp of the realities of the anti-communist mania that was gripping the racist regime. And I quote what he said. He said, "This bill purports to be directed against communism in general and against the Communist Party of South Africa in particular. The ANC executive is satisfied that it is primarily directed against the Africans and other oppressed people, and to frustrate all their attempts to work for the fulfillment of their legitimate demands," unquote. Sisulu's observation was very prophetic, for indeed in less than 10 years, the ANC was declared an illegal organization in terms of the very same act which was purportedly intended for the Communist Party of South Africa, or for the communists in general. Now, whilst it is correct to say that anti-communism has had, since the McCarthy era, a pervading influence in the US affairs, there can be no doubt that it is really during the Reagan administration that anti-communism, US anti-communism, has had the most direct and the most devastating effect in Southern Africa. Reagan's entry into the international political scene with his anti-communism at fever pitch sounded like music in the racist regime's ears. It shall be remembered that in coming to power, Reagan himself referred to the South African regime as the wartime allies. In fact, he was saying that the US government cannot afford to abandon its wartime allies at the hour of need. Historically and otherwise, that is incorrect, because the people that are high-level representatives of the South African government presently, there is historical and documentary evidence of this effect, where in fact, during the Second World War, when South Africa was involved in the war effort on the side of the Allies, they were in fact on the side of the Nazi regime and were incarcerated in South Africa for sabotaging the war effort and for acting as some kind of fifth column of the Nazi regime in South Africa. We are now being told that these, in fact, are the wartime allies. The Reagan administration policy of constructive engagement was predicated on the notion that the liberation movements in Southern Africa, namely the ANC and SWAPO, as well as the sovereign states in Southern Africa, were under the influence and or control of the Soviet Union and were about to deliver the whole region to Moscow. On the other hand, the regime was perceived in Washington as the guardian of Western civilization and culture against the invading communists, and therefore had to be strengthened in every manner, including military. Even though this act constituted a gross violation of the UN-imposed arms embargo in the Security Council, where the United States voted in favor. But what we have seen since the coming into power of the Reagan administration was that the South African army has been greatly strengthened. Armaments, technology, and everything has been, in fact, supplied to the South African regime, violating the UN arms embargo, and as I said, which the US administration has supported. At the same time, assistance to the South African regime was not confined to the military. We have been told time and again that the whole question of imposition of sanctions against the South African regime was not acceptable for a number of reasons. One of the reasons that the Reagan administration has advanced is that sanctions just don't work. Incidentally, this is also an argument that comes from many Western governments, including the Thatcher government. But we are amazed at the double standards that are practiced by such governments, where on the one hand, sanctions against Poland do work, sanctions against Libya do work, sanctions against Cuba do work. But when it comes to imposing sanctions against the apartheid regime, we are told that sanctions cannot work. The other reason that is very popular is that sanctions will hurt black people more than anybody else. Now, the African people in South Africa are sick and tired of this type of argument. We are told that we are going to suffer most. We have never at any stage said that we are not going to suffer as a result of sanctions. But the question should be put this way. Incidentally, people would be saying, in a country where everybody is poor and unemployment is very high, if you pull out the investments, you are going to create a situation where you are going to increase unemployment. And if you go and ask a worker and say to him, would you like this company to close down and that you be out of the job? The worker will obviously say no, and that is used as evidence to show that sanctions don't work, that the black people don't want them. But the question should be put differently. If you say to the worker, would you like this kind of system that is operating here, a system where your children are shot down in the streets without any kind of qualms out of the part of the regime? Would you like a situation where the black people, by dint of their color, are going to remain the hewers of wood and the drawers of water? Would you like a situation where imprisonment without trial has become the order of the day? And would you like a situation where international companies are continuing through their investments in South Africa to support a regime which is practicing all these things? Clearly, the answer would be a big no. So we have to learn to pose the right questions and at the right time, and we should not allow excuses of this kind to be used. Now, the real reason which accounts for the interest of the Reagan administration in Southern Africa was aptly put by no other than Chester Crocker, who said, that the 10 countries of Southern Africa are of vital interest to the United States, primarily because of the abundance of the mineral resources, especially the so-called strategic minerals, which are of critical interest to the United States, incidentally, which are important in the armaments industry. Because of the huge investments, economic investments, that are in South Africa by U.S. companies, which account for something to the tune of $7.2 billion, that was in 1980. And also South Africa becomes important to the U.S. administration because of its strategic location, which it is in the all-important oil route from the Middle East to the so-called Western world. And these are the reasons why the United States is interested in South Africa. These are the reasons why the United States wants to maintain the status quo in South Africa. In short, what the people of South Africa and the people of the region are being told is that their aspirations, their quest for national independence, their quest for national liberation should be subordinated to the interests of the United States. Now, there is nobody that can accept this kind of argument. The United States is a very big world, but we are very sorry. We cannot accept that kind of argument. What has constructive engagement done in Southern Africa? It has led to a massive military buildup. It has given encouragement to the South African regime that the regime can go on without fearing international condemnation, go on to embark on a reign of terror, unleash a reign of terror, declare the state of emergency, have hundreds of thousands of people arbitrarily arrested, including something like 10,000 children. This is the first of very few countries in the world, I think, where you'd have children arrested, children under the age of 16, in some cases 11, arrested under a law which is intended to safeguard the security of the state. In other words, an 11-year-old child is perceived by the government as a very grave threat to the security of the country. Concentration camps have been established so that the children who are released are not actually released to the custody of their children, of their parents, but are set up in certain institutions. The idea is that they have to be deprogrammed. Thank you very much. Deprogrammed. In other words, where the ANC and the Democratic Movement have brainwashed, allegedly, the children, the government has taken it upon itself to clean their brains and to present them as honorable citizens who are going to, you know, live as such. But the problem is this, that the Reagan administration's anti-communism has not only had a negative effect on South Africa itself, it has had a very devastating effect on the entire region.